Hello and welcome to the Ritual Misery Podcast, episode beta 64 for Friday, the 15th of January, 2016. This is a show where two lifelong friends talk about geek stuff and whatever else comes to mind. I'm Amos, and I finally got it right. Kent, shut the hell up.
What's up, man? Oh my God, you sound sick, dude.
What happened? Yeah, well, I feel sick, so that coordinates, right?
Yeah, did you get the Ebola or the...
No, I got the Chinese Yellow Dust Lung Butter Express.
Oh, yeah, that's a nasty one. So we got somebody in the studio with us.
That's bullshit.
Oh, yeah, because we're not all in the same studio.
The that virtual nice. Studio.
Yeah, that would be nice if we just had one. Yeah, Richard Gunther, welcome back to Ritual Misery. What's up, man?
Hello. Good to be back, guys.
You know, Ken says it'd be nice if he just had one studio. He's right. If any of us had an actual studio, it'd be great.
That would be nice, wouldn't it?
We could just timeshare it or something.
Yeah, this spare bedroom / living room shit is getting old. Richard, how are you, man? How are you? You've been you went out to dinner tonight.
I did. Yeah, sorry about the after dinner attire or whatever you call this. And I've been drinking wine all night, so I'm not switching to beer now. So I'm sticking with wine. Sorry, if it's obnoxious, too bad. Here, I'll make it less obnoxious. I got a whole bottle.
There we go. Hell yeah. Man, it sucks that you can't drink, Amos, because a shot of whiskey would probably do you good right now.
A shot of a lot of stuff. I got a handle of rum in the freezer right now, just waiting to chill out some Dr. Pepper, some Coke, and I can't do that either. So
you know, rum is the perfect ingredient for the hot toddy, I think.
I've never actually had a hot toddy.
Yeah, well, whiskey is really good in a hot toddy, too.
I can tell you that that rum is really good for my happiness.
We used to do Jack Daniels, honey, and lemon juice, I think it was, for our like homemade cough syrup.
Yeah, you lost me at Jack Daniels.
Yeah, right. It was the drink of choice for too long.
Yeah, for many years in high school. Yeah, it is no longer a choice drink. It is now a just whiskey in general. I just don't do whiskey.
Yeah, I'm not a whiskey fan, but you know it is good in the you need something warm and soothing when you're sick kind of drink.
Yeah.
So
true that.
Well, we actually have a show going on. We're not just sitting around shooting the shit the whole time. So
I thought that's what this was about.
It really is, but we have structure to it. Like we have show notes that nobody bothers to fill in.
Wait! Did you look at the show notes last week?
Did you see the show notes last week?
I didn't see them because I wasn't on the show.
They said pay attention to Tay.
Yeah, pretty much.
Like that's hard, right?
Well, in a manner of speaking.
There's going to be a lot of that tonight, I bet.
Wow. Well, I wish I was half as drunk as either one of you guys.
So I'm a little disappointed this week.
Uh-oh.
Because I'm not a billionaire or even a millionaire.
Oh.
Yeah, seriously. Hey, you know, I want to show off my losing tickets. I'm really proud of my losing tickets. Actually, I think I won $2 on these.
There you go. Right.
That's $2 more than what I won, but it's also probably about, it looked like about $20 there, more than what I spent as well.
Right. So there's that. So it was a net loss. But you know what? It is fun to think about it, isn't it?
Oh, it is. It is.
What was the final $1.6 billion?
It was like $1.5, I think is what I read. But it was split three ways. So I think when all was said and done, they each got like 400 and something million.
You know, if I had to settle with that, less taxes, so we're really talking about like 2.5 to 3 something hundred million dollars, I could probably live on that if I had to.
Yeah.
I mean, if I just had to.
Look, I'm willing to adjust my budget, all right? I'm willing to adjust my budget to live within those means.
I mean, let's face it, none of us lives in a flyover state, so we're never going to win it.
Yeah.
Right? Sorry, but that's typically what happens.
Jeez.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Is this not the show where I'm supposed to be offensive to people? Am I in the wrong place?
Oh, no, you are absolutely in the right place.
All right.
Yeah, we can always edit it out later, but we probably absolutely will not do that.
When does that happen?
What is this editing you speak of?
By the way, I think you had, Tay in the show last week. I can't possibly live up to that. So let's just make that really clear.
Well, you can try.
I don't even want to know what that looks like.
Just be the best you.
I will be the best me.
And we will be happy with that.
and the best me in most cases is an angry me. And I'm a fairly angry me because I was out at my partner's company's Christmas party or holiday party or post holiday party or whatever the political thing is that you're supposed to say.
The time they regift all the shit they didn't want that they got for Christmas.
We had a really nice dinner out at a really nice restaurant, and I drive home in the shitty rain weather to find that my house is dark.
Because you
forgot to turn a light on?
Yeah, you didn't turn the porch light on?
Now, you know I have a home automation system, right? So that shouldn't happen.
Okay, so you forgot to tell the system to turn the light on. Okay.
No. So apparently my generator, when it went off after restoring lighting when I wasn't here, failed to actually turn the electric back on when it turned off. You know, because why should it do that? I mean, I only, I don't know, paid as much as a friggin' car for the thing. So why should it be smart enough to turn the electric back on when it's done?
Look, you had one job.
Right.
Oh, my. Yeah, I think I'd be a little upset if I paid that much money for something.
I don't know. How
do a job and then.
How loud is it?
It's not that bad, actually. It's like a fairly quiet lawnmower. It's not bad. It runs on propane.
I have to ask because in Indiana we had people that had, you know, whole house generators. They'd cut it on, and that's all you would hear. The entire neighborhood was this one guy's generator. So,
oh yeah, there was a guy that had an actual tractor hooked to his house, and that was his generator. So every time we'd have an ice storm or something, you would hear a tractor running, and sure as shit, it was the neighbor's tractor hooked up to his house.
You know, it's a whole home generator, and we can choose. This is the thing that's funny about this, right? It's like when you buy a dishwasher, you decide how loud do you want it to be. So when you buy a generator, you have options for how well insulated do you want it to be. Do I give a shit about my neighbors, or do I not give a shit about my neighbors?
Right.
We like our neighbors, so we got one that was fairly well insulated.
Yeah. See,
it doesn't come on when it's done, but you know.
But hey, it's quiet.
Yeah, yeah.
It's quiet when it's running.
It's definitely quiet.
Yeah, it's really quiet.
When it's not on, that's amazing.
Oh my gosh.
I'm trying not to die over here. Every time you make me laugh, I'm about to cough my brains out.
Yeah. I hope you're doing okay. Are you doing okay?
No, I'm not gonna make it. It's not gonna happen.
So at your holiday dinner or post holiday dinner or whatever, did they have holiday beverages? Like, did they have any like special winter beers or holiday beers or anything?
No. This was like I'm drinking wine because we had wine at the table. And I know better than to switch midstream. I'm not done drinking. So
right.
More wine. Cheers. Yep.
Stick with what you started with.
Right.
Yeah, it's probably wise. So, earlier this week, I saw Star Wars for the fourth time.
Oh, my God. I still haven't seen it once.
That sucks. That really, really sucks.
See, you're in luck, though. Me and Kent can tell you all about it. You won't even have to go watch it.
So here we go. I have Court Fuller's episode. I have two of your episodes, all three episodes on pause at the point where you're about to get into more spoilers.
All right. So basically, how it starts out, there's an opening crawl. It says Star Wars, followed episode by episode seven.
Seven. God damn it. Why did you spoil that?
But the real thriller of the whole thing, though, there's more words after that.
They're in yellow or something.
The Force Awakens.
Yeah, it's
wait. What color are they?
I think they're yellow.
Yellow.
Oh.
Yeah. Like, there's no reason for you to watch it now. We done told you the first 10 seconds.
Right. It's pretty amazing. It's a great show. I saw.
I bet the end titles are blue.
Ooh, you know, I don't know. I was too busy crying.
Ooh, yeah. Oh.
I've heard that from a lot of people. I've heard that from a lot of
people. Yeah. No, you will experience a lot of emotions.
Yeah.
Not just one.
I might have heard that from a couple of high school girlfriends. What?
Oh, damn. So what did you do geeky this week, Amos?
So I got my cast off.
Ta-da! Yep.
For the video watchers, they can see I actually have a hand.
So you
and
don't
you
have
are
to
right-handed,
I am.
Right?
I am.
So now you don't have to do the stranger.
How are you doing, dude? How's it feel to have that hand free now?
So my teeth feel cleaner. My teeth feel cleaner. it's weird. Like, I can write now. That's like my big thing is I can write.
Really? Really? Yeah. That's where you're going with that?
Yeah.
It's my third favorite thing about getting the cast off.
Other than writing and brushing my teeth, pretty much everything else I'm still doing with my left hand.
Oh my God.
All right. There you go, chat realm.
Yep. There you go.
Oh, that's amazing.
That's just how it works out.
Wow.
I switched hands and it's just gotten comfortable. I don't want to go back.
Yeah. Excellent.
But my big thing was I asked my doctor, you know, after I got the cast off, I was like, so he's like, well, you need to move your thumb around and try to break through some of the scar tissue and get some of that flexibility back and this and that. And I was like, okay. Can I play video games? He was like, well, that's probably actually the perfect physical therapy for you.
Oh.
So doctor's stamp of approval, I get to play video games. Now, having said that, I have not played video games once since then because I've been so busy with other shit.
That's how it goes. Damn it.
So even when I get the fun physical therapy, I still don't take time to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that kind of sucks.
Yeah, I got Fallout 4 just begging for me right now. That's what she said.
So what about...
And yeah. A permission slip.
Yes. Which is way better than what I got in high school.
right. So what about you, Richard? Did you do anything geeky?
Well, I don't know. This week, not so much. Last week, CES, that's pretty damn geeky.
That's pretty fucking geeky.
All right, so I have to ask you about CES, man. How many times have you been?
So this was my 11th year there.
All in a row?
So I've been, for 10 years, so my first year there, yeah, all in a row. My first year there was 2005. And no, sorry, 2006, my first year there. 2007 was the year that I was there doing that CNET contest backstage crew thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that was 9 years ago from the day that I was there, which was pretty freaking cool because I was there this year and it was my 10th time. You know, if I counted that as kind of like the quintessential CES for me, and it really was. Because that's the thing that kind of got me into this whole thing. That's what got me into covering consumer electronics. That's what got me into podcasting. The folks, just very similar to you, Amos, you know, the folks at CNET and listening to their shows and following what they were doing, I wanted to be doing this stuff myself. but I knew I wouldn't be happy with the pay. So, you know... I have a job and I do this on the side.
See, that's
and I love it.
My problem is I have a job and I do this on the side, but there's too much job and not enough of this. So,
yeah, I hear right. you. I hear you. It just so happens that I love my job and I've happened to figure out the right mix of being able to blend my job and my passion. So, not everybody gets a chance to do that.
So what was your favorite thing about CES this year?
Wow, that's really hard, actually. So this was not a big, huge new stuff year at CES. This was a year of markets maturing and products evolving. And I think it's no big surprise that the big topics at CES this year were VR, AR, virtual reality, augmented reality, and drones. Like, that was the big thing. Kind of none of that is terribly interesting to me. And all of that is not interesting to me for the pretty much the same reason, which is that I have shit for depth perception. So I'm never going to fly a drone. And AR, VR is kind of lost on me. It's like 3D movies. It's just like, I don't get it.
Right.
So for me, the thing that I was interested in, and this was a pretty big thing, but it wasn't perhaps as hot as the AR, VR stuff because it didn't get the press attention, but connected home. Obviously, I'm big on that.
Mm-hmm.
And that was really big this year. You know, connected appliances, connected home, connected security and cameras. Everybody had a freaking camera. If you weren't selling a connected camera at CES this year, you just weren't cool. So, you know, there was a lot of that. My favorite thing at CES wasn't a new product. It was products that already exist being able to talk together. So... Mm-hmm. My colleague, Chris, who occasionally shows up on my show, Home On, and supports us at CES for the Digital Media Zone, he got me hooked on Sonos. And I mean, like, Sonos is like a drug. And I don't know if any of you know people who have Sonos or if you have Sonos, but you buy one, and man, you're itching, you got to buy another. And that, you know, it sounds awesome. Oh my God, it's so good. I got to get more. No. I'm good. I don't have to buy more. And then like 2 months later, you're just, you know, you're sneaking around that area, the Best Buy. You're like, oh, come on. It's not that much. It's not really, I can do that. All right. Okay. I'll get one more. I have 7 freaking Sonos widgets around my house. Right. I am like so sucked into this drug ecosystem. It's not even.
So what is it about it that is so appealing?
Oh, man. So the sound out of Sonos devices is really good. The services that they offer with their app, they pretty much tie into everything nowadays. They tie into, you know, you're an Apple Music guy, you're set. You're an Amazon Music guy, you're set. Spotify, you're good. You got Deezer with your crap super quality music that nobody's listening to. You're good. You got that too. Whatever service you want, they have it available to you. And the sound quality of their speakers is really, really good. So I have them all around my house and they synchronize perfectly. You just turn another one on. They're all in sync. They're all wireless. It doesn't hit on your Wi-Fi. It creates kind of its own network and everything. I think it's awesome. It also takes a big hit on the wallet. I mean, these things are not friggin' cheap. The cheapest fucking Sonos you can buy is $200.
Oh,
$200
shit.
For one speaker. And that's the cheapest one you can buy.
And that's the entry level.
That's the entry level. Right. That's the entry level drug. Oh. There's no free drug model here, right?
That's my God.
Entry level. But they sound amazing. They're great. If you know, if you're willing to put the money into it, a lot of people have bought into them. They're very popular. My home automation system that I have, I use a system called Insteon. It is sold by smarthome.com. It's actually a subsidiary of smarthome.com. I've been using it since it came out 10 years ago. I have helped to write and build software for it. It's great stuff. And they just announced that their system integrates with Sonos. So you know what that means? That means I can have a wake-up scene where my favorite morning music comes on, or I can walk in the house and when I open the door, the channel that I would normally listen to automatically comes on. Or when I say that it's bedtime and I press that button, then I'm going to bed, all the speakers turn off. So that kind of thing, that kind of blending of your home AV experience with your home automated and control experience, for me, that is like the perfect quintessential kind of I don't even know what the right term is, but it's thinking, you know, it's automation in all aspects of your life, and I'm loving it. And that was my favorite thing at CES.
Nice.
That's really cool, actually, because like you said, that's something that's not really covered that well in the media.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah, so it's good.
They,
it's
you
good
know, they're more excited about the ridiculous fucking refrigerator with a 27 inch screen on it. Come on, are you kidding me?
But it tracks your milk.
Well, yeah, because that's important.
And actually, you know, this is what kills me about this, right? I think the ability for a refrigerator to keep track of the food that is potentially going to or has already spoiled in your possession, that is valuable. There's no doubt. I mean, Americans waste, statistically, Americans waste between a quarter and a third of all the food that they buy because it spoils. That's just like core numbers across the board. Mm-hmm. That's a shit ton, a ridiculous shit ton of resources that we're wasting, mm-hmm. and money that we're wasting, and people that we're not feeding.
It's not
right?
just the I food, mean, though. Just, it's also the whole supply chain, the distribution chain, the gas spent to get the food there and everything else.
Yeah, yeah. So if we can come up with ways of knowing when your food is going to spoil and that your food has spoiled or that it's about to spoil, that is valuable, and we can do that. But, oh, my God, you don't need a 27-inch screen on your television or on your refrigerator to do that. Come on, that's ridiculous. Let's just wait till the first update where they're like, sorry, we're no longer supporting this operating system.
Right. Yeah. And then I listened to 99% Invisible this week, the new episode, and they're talking about expiration dates and stuff, and it's pretty much just an arbitrary number that they randomly throw out there depending on the state, the manufacturer, and all kinds of other factors that didn't actually give you real information. It's great. So now you have a 27-inch TV checking dates and numbers that are arbitrarily thrown out there that are falsely giving you this sense of security that the food isn't spoiled so that you can throw out stuff earlier and more efficiently instead of actually using it, thusly wasting a third of your food budget for the country.
Yeah.
I love it.
There has to be a better way. I'm sure there's a better way. I know there are people working on this. I know you guys know that I believe in smart kitchen tech. I attended the Smart Kitchen Summit and facilitated some sessions there this past fall. There is great opportunity here for someone that can crack it, but the big screen on the refrigerator running friggin' Tizen, for God's sake, and you're... And being your home hub, come on. How long do hubs last? Maybe like a couple years. How long do you expect to get rid of, or how long do you expect to keep your refrigerator? No, forget that. It doesn't matter. It's going to be obsolete in 3 years. You'll get a new one, right?
I mean,
no problem.
I just in my own mind, I have a very strong dislike for anything about a refrigerator becoming more of a hub for a family than it already is. Isn't America fat enough?
Yeah, because if you're standing at the refrigerator doing something with your home automation, I didn't think of it till just this moment, but I could use a snack.
Yeah, exactly. Look at that turkey sandwich right there.
I don't think that's what they're going for, but that's an interesting point.
That's what we're here for.
The refrigerator is just a bad place for that to be.
We bring
How about
tech
we just like put some
masses.
Sensors in the refrigerator that talk to your existing hub?
How about
talk to
how about
Alexa? That how, talk to
right.
How about you know, we put whatever. a weight scale on the bottom of right in front of the fridge, so when you go to step on it, if you're like 3 pounds overweight, you grab the handle and it's like and just shocks
nope,
you.
We are not opening this door for you. You failed the test.
Yeah, and you can tell how close to your goal weight you are by how much it shocks you.
Yeah.
You come back from a vacation in Hawaii and you're like 10 pounds overweight and it's like,
you're not eating for 4
exactly.
days.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Sergeant Muffin is pretty much saying the same thing in the chat. That's exactly right. It's like, nope, you failed.
Yep. Yeah, see how popular that is.
All right, so burning question on my mind is, were there any new Wacom products there?
I don't know of this company that you speak.
Yeah.
Do you mean Wacom? Were there Wacom products? Is that what you mean?
Oh, I don't know. All my friends call it Wacom. So.
Oh, well, see, I forgot to tell you. While I'm on the show, I'm going to be that obnoxious guest. Because, you know, nobody expects anything different, right? While I'm on the show, I'm going to correct your pronunciation and grammar. So it's Wacom, not Wacom.
Okay.
And the next time someone says me and anything, I'm going to be down your throat on it. All right. So we're going to fix this.
I don't know.
So
me,
if me and Amos say.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Just like that. You mean Amos and I? Yeah. If Amos and I say this, then yeah.
Got it. Okay. Copy.
I could be that guest.
So I do have a question for you about Vegas in general, though. Are you more of an In-N-Out guy or a Five Guys guy?
Oh my God. So Five Guys kind of originated on the East Coast and I'm a big fan of Five Guys, but man, when I go to the Western states and I have an opportunity to go to In-N-Out, I am so an In-N-Out guy, but I'm not a secret menu guy. I just want the plain old burger with my fries. That's all I want.
Yep. That's, I get the number one, which is the double. It's a double, double, I believe.
Yep. Yep. I love their stuff. Great food. I try to go there every time I can. The In-N-Out in Vegas is not conveniently located. I assume you've been to Vegas.
Kent used to live there, so.
I lived there for like 5 years.
Okay, so you know that everything in Vegas looks like it's a block away. Everything that looks like roughly a block is approximately a mile and a half.
Yeah, yeah. We used to always say that everything was 20 minutes away. In Vegas, just pretty much wherever you want to go, it takes 20 minutes, whether it's on foot or by car.
Yeah. Unless you're just going from one end of the strip, which look, it's just like 7 hotels down. We'll be right there. Don't worry about it. And then you're there like an hour and a half later.
Well, right, yeah.
Because the only way to get there is to walk like through the back of half of the hotels and through 17 food courts. And
And no matter what, no matter how hungry you are, you see that buffet and you're like, $6, I'd go for a buffet.
I could use another.
Left a buffet. Yeah, but this one's got shrimp.
I wouldn't know where I can still find a $6 buffet because
it's off
do
strip.
Not know of any, perhaps, except for the Excelsior, and I'm not ever, ever, ever eating at the Excelsior.
Oh, yeah, man.
You got to go off strip for the really cheap buffets.
So while you're in Vegas, do you hit any of the rides? Like the roller coasters and things?
Yeah, so I've been on New York, New York. They have, like, this roller coaster thing there.
Can't like that one because it makes me throw up.
That beats the shit out of you. I don't care. I love coasters. I love, like, free fall rides and shit like that. I love that. The New York, New York ride, though, it beats the shit out of you. And, like, I don't need that. I'm 50 years old. Like, I value my neck, right? I don't want to put up with that crap. So what I used to love, there was this great roller coaster at the hotel formerly known as the Sahara. They had an awesome coaster that was a really quick and like crazy fast and smooth ride that ended in a vertical pinnacle. And then when you got to the top, it went backward and it took you backward.
Yeah, that was at the NASCAR Cafe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
My only complaint about it is it only lasted like 20 seconds or something.
It was really, really short, but it was a great ride. It's gone.
Yeah.
It's gone.
It's been gone for years now.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it was, I mean, they closed the Sahara years ago. It reopened, I think, 2 years ago as the SLS. Really, actually, very nice hotel and casino, but they took out the best part, which was the ride. And I don't get that. And then their rides on the top of the Stratosphere. And guys, those rides, those are not rides. Those are like temptation machines to laugh in the face of God. And I just can't do that. I just can't do that. They have a teeter-totter on the edge of a tower. They have one of those, you know, like whirly-doo carousel things where they swing you out as with centripetal force, so you're way on a swing at the top of a tower. You know, yeah, no, that's not happening. And then they have some other thing. I forget what it is. I think it's like a ride that goes straight up.
Yep.
And then it goes down.
That's the one that I've done.
Yeah, that's
all of them. Laughing in the face of God. No, not going to do it.
Me and Kent did. We wouldn't do the tip over one because that was just dumb.
Kent and I.
Yeah. See. we did the one
when
that shoots you straight
up.
So
when Amos came to visit, me and Amos went up, and we did the.
You mean? You and Amos. You and Amos did that.
So Amos and I went on the one that shoots you straight up in the air, and the feeling that you have when you reach the pinnacle, it still feels like you had not stopped. It feels like you are still going.
Right. So it's giving you something like a weightlessness sensation, right?
Yeah. Oh my God. Yeah. I thought the ride had broken and we had broken free from this thing. And we were going to die. That's what it felt like.
That's awesome.
It was awesome about 3 seconds later when I realized that I'm safe.
Right. And you realized, oh, shit, now I'm going to have to clean my pants when I get off.
Yeah, pretty much.
So didn't one of you go to Disney recently or in the fairly recent future or something? Have you talked about ever? I don't know. I don't remember. Have you ever talked about being on the Tower of Terror at Disney? Either of you?
We didn't make it. We didn't make it to Hollywood Studios.
So, yeah. So you wouldn't find it. Hollywood Studios. Yeah, Disney Hollywood Studios. Yeah. So that is a great ride. If you ever get a chance to do that, that is one of those things where you honestly don't know if you're going up or you're going down. At the particular moment, because they're moving you and changing the acceleration direction so quickly that you don't know what the fuck is going on, and it's awesome.
See, that's like the one ride there that I really, really wanted to go on. And we never made it to that park. We hit all the others, but we didn't make it to that one.
Need to do it. Need to do it.
Yep.
So I heard that
Ritual Misery Disney trip.
Oh, I'm down. I am so down.
For yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Totally.
Yeah. California or Florida?
Florida.
That's a Florida ride. But actually, they added that to California. The ride is a little bit different, but they do have the ride in California now.
I've been to both.
I've got one last question
you,
about Vegas. Oh, okay. What's that, Amos? I didn't mean to step on you.
Oh, I've been to both, and I'm telling you, Florida's better.
Can someone open my wine for me? I can't seem to get this.
Yeah. Just hand it over. I got it. So I just got one last question about Vegas. I heard that the cabs accept credit cards now. Is that true?
Oh, okay. Yeah. So the cabs accept. Yeah. Have you been following my Twitter? You have. You're baiting me, aren't you?
What?
So
what?
Yes. The cabs accept credit cards. And that took what? How many years? That took. I don't even know. 2 years ago, maybe 1 year ago, they finally started to accept credit cards. That's awesome.
The whole time I lived there, I don't know how many times I had to tell the cabbie to take me to an ATM
right,
so I could pay. Yep.
Right. That credit card is going to cost you $3. It doesn't matter if your cab ride is a $12 ride or a $73 ride. That credit card is going to cost you $3. Oh, that's a convenience fee.
Oh,
sorry. Well, it's the credit card fee. No, it's not the credit card fee. The credit card fee is 2.5%. You are fucking raking me over the coals. So after the first time that I took a cab that gave me the convenience of accepting my credit card, I took Uber from there on.
Yes.
Fuck
that was gonna Yeah, that was going to be my next question. What about Uber or Lyft?
Right. Uber is in town and it's awesome.
Yeah.
And I had so many great Uber drivers and so many great Uber experiences. And I'll tell you, the hotels are, and particularly the drivers, are not happy about it at all because, you know, the drivers, they're losing money, and the hotels, well, you know, the drivers grease the hotels.
Right.
So, right. You know, nobody's happy about the fact that Uber is really the drive of choice these days.
Yeah, because the hotels need the extra money.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, because at CES, they're not charging you four times their normal hotel rate, plus $17.95 for Wi-Fi.
Oh, oh, my God. Are you serious? Holy
shit. Some hotels are charging close to $20 for Wi-Fi.
Wow.
Is that per stay or per day?
No, that's per day.
Oh. No.
Oh, my God.
Nope. They realize my overage charges on my Verizon bill aren't that high, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Like I could hotspot. Yeah, I was going to say I could hotspot like three rooms and never even get close to that.
Yeah, that's sick.
So that's what I did is I took my hotspot and I used that pretty much the entire time.
Mm-hmm. That's nuts.
Did any of the Uber drivers drive a Prius? Those are like the hot thing.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember. I think I had one Prius. What was really funny is, you know, in Vegas, everything's about the show, right? So
now, regardless if it's CES or not, everything's about the show.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
It's about being flashy and pretending that you have more money than you do, and so, you know, people take limousines and black cars all the time, even though they normally never would, because that's what you do in Vegas. So a lot of the drivers on Uber had really nice cars, and to be able to get as many rides as possible, many of the people who were driving, like, you know, brand new Mercedes, brand new vehicles of any kind, were basically signing themselves up for everything. Uber X, Uber Select, Uber black car, whatever. You like, if you had the right vehicle that could qualify for anything and under, they just qualified themselves for whatever so they could get as many rides as possible. And it seemed to be working because, man, I got some really nice. I mean, there were a couple times when I was riding in like a Mercedes S-Class or a BMW 5 or better, and it was just like a regular old Uber X ride.
Wow.
So that's I cannot cool. complain. I love Uber. I know Uber has its problems. I know that a lot of people think that the Uber CEO is a big douchebag and whatever. I get it. I think he kind of has probably not demonstrated the best leadership skills or maybe the best political skills for a company that's trying to make inroads in local governments. But they provide a great customer service.
See, there was a thread about Uber getting stopped in Austin, and I haven't followed up on it. But man, if Uber's not there when we're there in South by Southwest, I'm gonna be completely disappointed.
Yep, absolutely.
So I remember when we were there last time. I think if I'm remembering correctly, I think I basically called an Uber for you guys to get. Well, not you, Kent, because you had kind of already been out for the count, but maybe for you, Amos, to get back to your place where you were staying. And was that your first Uber, or had you done Uber before elsewhere?
We had been actually doing Uber that we did Uber that whole that weekend going to Sixth Street, and then see, here's the key though. I paid for Kent to go back to the room with with the last $20 bill that I had.
So you should have called an Uber.
Well, it actually was an Uber, but I gave him the money, and I don't know where that went.
What? You didn't have to do that.
I know, but I was drunk.
Yeah, I don't. I kind of remember something about a bike taxi, and then, yep. Then I'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah.
That's
And that was kind of then he's fighting the floor back at the Airbnb we're staying at.
Yeah, I'm just glad we saw you the next day, man, because you were you had a good first night at South by Southwest,
which really sucked because South by so wasted the next day. I spent about the first half of that just
he was like South by so sober.
Yeah, like, he was already there. God. He was already there. He's like, oh, I don't know what you guys are talking about. I'm already there.
Yeah, yep. I was about three or four bottles of water in before I even thought about getting a beer.
It was great.
Understand.
Oh, God.
It was great.
It was a great time, man. You guys, so I know you guys were talking about it last week with Tay. Y'all are planning on doing this again, right?
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
For sure.
I've got reservations for the travel trailer. We'll be staying about 5 miles south of 6th Street.
Yeah, so tell me about this. Are you're renting a trailer or are you actually like driving one there?
Yep. My wife and I own a 35-foot travel trailer. We'll be driving it down there. Parking it at an RV park and staying there for the weekend.
That is freaking cool as shit.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
It's not quite all the luxuries of home. You only get like 3-minute showers, but you know, it works.
Yeah, but, you know, you have a place to stay. It's your own.
Yep.
And assuming that your porta potty works and you're willing to empty out the, you know, shit tank.
Yep.
And you also have your own bathroom without having to go out to outhouses. Well, I mean, come on. What's South by Southwest without a couple outhouses?
Those will happen anyway.
There are a lot of those.
Kent's actually stayed in the trailer before when he was staying at my place, what, New Year's a couple years ago?
Just last year. So
yeah. And I have a rule. Whoever shits first empties the black tank.
Oh.
Yep.
So that can't be good for y'all's health. I'm just saying.
Sometimes it's just luck of the draw.
Because someone... I mean, you know that there's at least one person that's just like holding it against their natural way, right? And they're like, nope, I am not going in there yet.
Oh, my God. Yeah, I agree with Sergeant Muffin. I could just live on cheese. So,
yeah.
So you're fine. I'm just going to block myself up for the whole week.
Yep.
And then cheese
and crackers.
That next week, you're just dying. Yep. Well, see, I have it to where it even applies to the kids. Like, the kids are the first ones to shit in the toilet. Nope. Grab some gloves. You're helping me with the tank.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well,
so.
You got to train them, right? Because they're going to have to help out at some point. They're going to have to, they're going to want to take it. Come on, you know, not soon after they're 16, someone's going to be saying, hey, you know, I really want to go camping with my friends. You know, is that cool? And you're going to be like, fuck no, that is not cool. And then they're going to ask again at 18, and you pretty much don't have the ability to say no, except to say, it's my fucking trailer. What are you paying me?
Yeah, exactly. Right. Exactly.
And they better know how to empty the shit tank.
Yep. That black tank better come back empty.
Don't bring it back full.
No. Better come back empty.
Shitter's full.
It's like a 40-gallon tank, so it'd take a while to... That's a lot of turds. It's not minor details there. Now that we've gone completely blue, like the water in the tank.
That takes so long on your show.
Yeah, no shit, right? So we have a couple... of these to talk about this week.
I know that sound.
Yes. Kent, why don't you go first?
All right. Harry Cliff, have we reached the end of physics?
Okay, first of all, I couldn't watch this.
Why is that?
Because his name is Harry Cliff.
And all you could think of was Harry Cliff.
It brings to mind too many different things. I couldn't.
Okay, so the original idea last week for Tay, the original TED Talks idea for Tay last week, ultimately she ended up doing the Tay Talk, which was fucking brilliant. It was great.
That was great. That was so funny.
The original idea for that, though, that she and I were talking about was that she was going to take a TED talk that we suggest to her, and then she is going to review it like we review TED talks, except in Tay fashion, which in itself would have been fucking hilarious.
Right.
But this was one of them that I suggested to her. And one of the things that stood out about it was, in fact, Harry Cliff's name. Because I'd love to hear what she has to say about that. But the other thing is that this TED Talk is full of geek speak and fucking over your head physics talk. I mean, you could, if you have, you know, a halfway intelligent mind, you can follow along with what he's saying generally, but you don't really get everything. This guy, he's on the team that runs the LHC for CERN, and he's talking about throwing atoms at each other, and he's talking about the possibility of us, now that we've found the Higgs boson, that that might be it. Like, we might keep trying new shit and testing out theories, but not being able to get any deeper than that with physics. We could go another 1,000 years and not be able to advance physics anymore.
I don't even know what that means. Like, we can't learn anything more, or we can't
find any smaller particles, is what he's alluding to. And
maybe that's all there is. Like, maybe that's as small as it fucking gets.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And that's kind of what he's talking about. But I hate to say that he's using big words or words that are too big or whatever, but he kind of is. He's talking, I don't know, maybe I'm just not as smart as everybody else, but he seems to be like talking above the audience level about
he's
physics.
He's a physicist.
Right, exactly. But, you know, I don't know. It was an interesting talk to me. Because he did present some ideas that I hadn't really considered, because he talks a lot about like Einstein and his theories. And we're just now, like 100 years later, just now getting around to proving or disproving or finding links with like string theory and all this other stuff. Like, I say string theory like I know what it is, but I only very, very little know what it is. But Anyway, it's interesting if you're up for feeling kind of dumb. So
that is quite an endorsement.
Wow. Okay. Well, I'm gonna swing this the opposite way.
All right.
Jill Heinerth, the mysterious world of underwater caves.
I totally misread this title. I thought it said the mysterious world of underwear.
Oh, see. That would have been a far better talk. The only actual science that she gives this entire time is showing these little animals that have been around that are basically the same as they were previous to the dinosaurs' extinction. Other than that, it sounds like she's talking to a bunch of 10-year-olds about like a career day.
Don't we already know about these things? I mean,
right. Well, then the camera pans around to the audience, and it's a bunch of 10-year-olds. Literally.
Like, literally 10-year-olds.
Yeah, like literally 10 or 12-year-olds.
So it sounds like she's talking to 10-year-olds because she's
actually talking to
10-year-olds.
This is a TED TED audience full of 10-year-olds.
Yes.
TED or TEDx?
I don't even know. It was the number one story or number one speech on the page. So I just clicked it and watched it. And wow. I would have... personally, she shows pictures of her cave diving. Okay, sounds really cool and everything. Yeah,
I mean, right.
Until all the pictures she shows are her like pinched in between these massive fucking rocks, crawling her way through with all these tanks and shit hanging off of her, and my claustrophobia kicks in. I'm like, fuck no, there's not a goddamn chance. And then it shows her like she's free diving, you know, just going through, or not free diving because she's actually still got gear on, but she's going through, and then her exhaust air is bubbling up and creating these little pockets. And all I can think of is, if you're researching this area that no one's ever been before, why aren't you using a regenerative system to where the gases are trapped in the system, as opposed to just going up and who knows what the fucking little plankton or whatever else is down there is going to do with the newfound oxygen and carbon dioxide pockets? You know, Like, you don't know that's not going to fuck up the entire ecosystem of this cave that's 300 feet underground under a damn subway somewhere that nobody ever knew about until you started giving them all kinds of new shit.
Well, there is I know there's a name for it. I don't know what the name is, but there's some scientific posit that you can't observe. You really can't observe something in its native environment without impacting the native environment.
Right. But there's a difference between watching it and pissing on it. You know what I mean? And that's kind of because it's her exhaust gas. It's not only the wetsuit and whatever happens to be living on it, but also whatever germs she's breathing out in, from her fucking air. So, Dr. Payne says just breaking the prime directive all over the place. Exactly.
Yes, it is. Yep. It is probably a major prime directive violation.
So, although that's what we do, though.
Let's be fair about this. There was a lot of this in their activities too. In fact, I think they made a whole movie out of it, but and it was a pretty bad movie. So was there anything new? Did she present anything that we didn't already know?
Me personally, no, zero zilch, not a nothing.
Well, that's because you're not 10.
Exactly. So.
Jeez.
All right. Well, tell me you found something
really
more
disappointing for the last couple of weeks. So I might as well just contribute to this trend. So I watched a TED Talk called "A New Vision for Rebuilding Detroit" by Toni Griffin, and I know you guys know that I'm big into IoT and smart home and smart city stuff. And Detroit is one of the areas where building smart grid and smart community and smart city technology is A, already happening, and B, makes a whole lot of sense because so much of the infrastructure is ripe for either complete replacement or just non-existent. And so they need to put stuff in place. And so I'm really interested in what's going on in Detroit and how are organizations working to rebuild Detroit. So I figured I'd give this a listen. And she apparently is an architect and has a history in urban rebuilding and urban renewal. And I feel like I didn't, and maybe it's because I've been so involved in knowing what Detroit is up to and how they're trying to rebuild, but I feel like I didn't really learn anything. I felt like she talked about how actually the one thing that I thought that she said that was really interesting is that, you know, a significant portion of Detroit, which is kind of equivalent to the combination of Chicago, Manhattan, and Philadelphia all combined together. Like the physical space that makes up Detroit is larger than those three physical areas geographically. So there's a lot of space. And a significant portion of Detroit is vacant, where it's just abandoned. And that's a part of the excuse me, the plague, if you will, that Detroit is trying to address. How do you correct, or how do you build up against the blight of vacated properties and vacated lots? And so in some areas, people have turned vacated lots into community gardens, which is awesome. That's great. And I think at one point someone came up with this theory that, we'll turn most of the vacant areas into like farmland. And so these people in Detroit can kind of, you know, sustain or create a self-sustaining environment with and actually farming in what's in urban areas. And one of the smartest things that I think she said was, really? Like, all these families moved into an urban area in our country so that they could become farmers again? No, that is not why you move into cities. And so she was talking about ways that you can perhaps rebuild a city that is you know, in need of you know, rebuilding, in need of rejuvenation, and talked about giving, you know, giving people who are otherwise maybe working out of their homes an opportunity to create businesses in vacant warehouses and vacant properties and stuff like that. And it's all great, but what I didn't hear and what I didn't understand is how people who live in Detroit, their income level is like by comparison terrible compared to many other cities. And so how do you enable the people who are living in these cities to actually, you know, get a hold of these properties and create businesses in these properties? That someone has to put money in. Somehow people have to be provided with grants or loans or opportunities that otherwise don't exist. So the idea was really good, but I don't understand how it would be executed. And that was kind of like the big missing piece for me. And for someone who cares deeply about this concept of like urban rebuilding and urban rejuvenation, because I've lived in DC and I've lived in DC from when like one block away from me where I lived was literally like whorehouses. And when I moved out of the city, it was the prime real estate, and kind of showing how you can rebuild. And DC still has a pretty good rate of still, you know, rejuvenating while still providing a decent amount of affordable housing for people who can't, you know, who can't afford what happens when regentrification in neighborhoods occurs. Hmm. So, yeah, I like the concept, but I didn't understand how it was going to happen.
That's one of those things. Anytime I'm in a city, because I grew up in Southern California, in the outskirts of what was then LA County, and in, you know, Palmdale, Lancaster, there was a lot of areas that would just get boarded up, and okay, well, nobody lives there anymore. And that was just a fact. Like, why not? Why is that area no longer habitable?
Right.
Or going to Abilene, Texas, where my family is now. There's entire areas of downtown that no one is using. Well, there's buildings there. Someone's paying taxes on it, right? Well, no. Actually, nobody's paying taxes anymore. They just abandoned them. Well, shouldn't there be like a period of time, like after you stop paying taxes for so long, the city owns it and can do with it whatever it needs? Like, give it to these new businesses that need warehouse space or that need an office front, you know? I mean, there's got to be some sort of program to where we can just reuse the same things we already have with minimal actual monetary investment. And still make them available to people who are willing to take the chance and take the risk and make something happen with it. But we don't. We just move on. We just continue the donut around the shittiness and keep spreading, you know, keep spreading the money outside. It just keeps going out to where everything in the middle is just abandoned.
I mean, I tend to think that there are smart people, and I have every reason to believe that she is one of these smart people, that have ideas to help make this happen. My complaint about the talk wasn't about her ideas. It was that I don't feel like she explained how it was going to be executed. Like, the idea is great.
Mm-hmm.
Build blocks that rejuvenate warehouses, build blocks that are actually, you know, generating green energy, build blocks that are, you know, some are dedicated to gardening and whatever else. A really good mix that could benefit a community. But how? And that's what it's easy to talk about what you should do. That's not fair, because it's hard to think about what you should do. But once you've thought about what you should do, then the really hard part is, how do you make it happen? And that's what I was hungry for. And that's what I felt that this didn't deliver.
Yeah, well, and that's kind of the thing about TEDs, though. TED is about ideas, not necessarily solutions. It's about ideas.
And yep.
So, you know, I mean.
And that's why Richard doesn't watch them on a regular basis.
What's that?
That's why Richard doesn't watch them on a regular basis.
Oh, right. Well, and it's funny, because that's what Tay was making fun of last week with her Tay talk.
Mm-hmm.
She said, I'm going to pose a lot that. Of a lot of questions and not answer any of them.
Answer anything.
Yes. And then she made sure to pimp her imaginary book at the end.
Yes. Oh man.
Okay. What so speaking of Tay from last week, we had an issue last week where she tried to call in to the group chat, to the group video with her cell phone, and it wouldn't work. So on Tuesday, I think this week, Skype announced that they're going to have video conference calls on mobile.
Oh,
by
yes.
By the end of the year. Yes. And I was like, well, by the end of the year, that's bullshit. You know, you should be able to, like, I don't understand. It's been 10 years since they've had video calling. Why is this not something they can just put out there? But I'm sure there's issues.
Because you could do that on a Hangout with Google. Today.
Yeah.
I mean, it sucks. God forbid that you have a meeting and you have to get to it from your mobile device. But if you just happen to have a link to it available, then you can do it. So why can't Skype, right?
Yeah, exactly. So
right.
I read that. And I was like, that was on Tuesday or whatever. And I was like, motherfuckers, like, you couldn't do that last week. You couldn't just come out with that last week.
Right, exactly. So did anybody watch the Golden Globes or at least read about them?
I saw a bunch of the dresses the women were wearing.
Yeah, no. All I did was read the results. I never watched those shows. I guess you got to have TV, like cable, to do that anyway. But I read the results, and I had to read something about 5 times to make sure that I was reading it properly. The Martian won Best Motion Picture in the category of musical or comedy.
Right. Mm-hmm. But in all fairness, that is not a fault of the Globes. They submitted it as
And that's what I read after the fact.
Right. So that's one of these things. Like, you know, what was it? I forget what it was. Whether it was was it West Wing or something like that, where one of these shows that was part comedy, part drama, was submitted one year to the Emmys as a comedy, and everybody's what?
See, I didn't even take it that far. I thought of, well, what comedy can I think of that was better than The Martian, that made me laugh more than The Martian did?
That's a good point.
And I couldn't come up with any. Like, The Martian was the funniest movie. Whether or not it's an actual comedy, I laughed more at The Martian than I did any other movie all year
long. There were many laughable points in The Martian, and even in the book. I mean, there were laughing points in the book. There were crying points in the book. So it's one of those things where they could claim whatever they want.
Sure. But what movie can't, really? Like, we were talking about Star Wars earlier. No, we won't even talk about the new one, but just any Star Wars
movie. It's comedy. It's clearly a comedy.
Right?
Oh, wait. No. Sorry. John Williams conducted the score. It's a musical.
Sure. Why not? That just kind of, I don't know. I wasn't real happy about that. But I'm glad they won. I'm glad
you haven't even seen the movie.
Because The Martian is a really, 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 really good movie. So I'm happy about that. It just kind of, it was off-putting that it was for comedy. I don't know.
You said you didn't see it, though, right?
What? The Martian?
The Martian?
Oh, no. I've seen it.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I love that movie. It's great.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, and I've seen it, so we can spoil it. I've read the Audible book.
Yeah. I still don't understand how that works, but okay.
What do you mean?
Like, you can't say that you listened to the book. Because then people are like, that's weird. But then you can't say you read it either, because it's an Audible book, so you didn't actually read it.
Yeah.
Like,
there needs to be a new term.
Yeah, there's this pseudo ground that we got to find a new term for.
We need to coin something. So instead of I read it or I listened to it, there needs to be something unique, meaning that I listened to an audio book.
Yeah,
or I listened to someone read to me.
Right. And audible's never going to be a good verb. You can't say you audibled it. That's just terrible.
No, because that immediately makes me think of football.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Yeah.
Yeah. So. But it's funny, though, because I have not listened to or read a full book probably in about 10 years. Not kidding.
Oh, wow.
Because I used to read a lot. And ever since I became sucked into this tech forecast, vortex. That's what I read. I read tech news and I listen to tech podcasts and podcasts started. So I listened to podcasts for tech and humor and news and everything else. And so I don't really have reading time. And I pretty much stopped reading books because it wasn't as important to me. But this is one book that so many people were raving about for so long. I'm like, all right, I got to try it. And I was totally sucked in, and it was awesome.
And in all fairness, there's plenty of fiction in tech world.
That's a really good point, especially if you go to CBS.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, my God.
Lots of fiction. Lots of fiction.
Yeah.
Okay, so speaking of reading, who wants to read 10,000 character tweets?
Oh, my God. Oh, kill me now.
Isn't this part of the beauty of Twitter? You're limited to 140 characters. It's short form. It's quick. It's in your face. And it's done. You move on.
Here's my example of why this already sucks. Because I want people to be able to contact me for press reasons. Like, I want people to be able to get a hold of me if they need to, because they're a vendor or because there's someone that wants to contact us for the blog or the show or whatever else. Mm. I have my private messages, my direct messages channel open. Anyone can contact me. And I had a representative from a PR agency associated with a vendor that I visited at CES contact me through my direct message channel today with a message that was longer than I could display on my 27-inch IMAX screen in Twitter. And I'm just like, fuck no, I am not replying to you. No, 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 no.
So he wrote you an email on Twitter.
Yeah.
Yeah, essentially. Oh, man, no way.
This is what's going to happen. You're going to have people just go off. If this happens, you're going to have people just go off on diatribes. I hate this idea. I hate it. I hate it. I hate it. I get it for direct messages. I don't get it for tweets. And if they go down this path, I think it is going to be a major step in the undoing of Twitter. And good God, I wish that they would just come up with a model that would allow people like me who love Twitter to pay a little bit to use Twitter on maybe an annual basis or something, so I don't have to put up with all this bullshit. Stop trying to figure out how to screw up Twitter and just let me fucking pay for it.
So Twitter, open a fucking Patreon. Do it now.
I don't know. God, it's like Moments, right? Like, what is that?
What a disaster. The only time that anybody ends up on Moments is when they accidentally tap that icon. You know it.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
You know it. That's the only time you've gone there.
I tapped on Moments the other day because I was just looking at my Twitter page and I was like, what the fuck is it? Like, I forgot what Moments was.
Right.
I clicked on it. I was like, oh, this dumb shit. Okay, back to my feed.
Right.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Mm. No.
Ugh.
No, I can't stand it. You'll understand this a little bit more than most, but when we write EPRs, you know, enlisted performance reports,
You mean when I used to?
Just shut up.
I don't do that anymore.
Just shut up. You fucking big flaming asshole
right
now.
It kills me that you have an initialism for that you call it an EPR.
Mm-hmm.
It's like your fucking meals. You have to have a three-letter initialism for your meal. You can't just call it a meal.
Well, it's got to be a meal ready to eat.
Government military.
All right, so my favorite one ever was an AEPC. AEPC stands for APU External Power Contactor. APU stands for Auxiliary Power Unit. So AEPC is an acronym.
Triple.
Yes, it's an acronymized acronym.
Well, that's like a CRO, a ComSec responsible officer, where ComSec is itself communication security.
At least in that. So this is another one of my grammatical pet peeves. At least in that model, ComSec is an acronym because you pronounce it. That's what defines an acronym. It's pronounceable. TLA, despite how funny it is not in fact a three-letter acronym.
TLA.
TLA. Yes, TLA. You just been
you
saying
you don't say TLA.
You could.
You could. Oh my God. People would think you're an idiot.
That's true.
That's true half the time anyway. So when we're writing EPRs, we have to fill the space. There's a certain amount of space in a line, and we have to fill it.
Space is bad.
You can't go over, because then it carries down to the next one, and well, that's going to ruin a bullet. And it can't be too short, because then it shows there's too much white space at the end, so now you don't care. So we have to fill it within one or two characters of the end, every single line, preferably at 0 point. You know what I mean? Well, I hate that. I fucking hate it. It's the stupidest shit. Well, not really, but it's one of the stupidest shits ever in the Air Force. However, on my Twitter, I find it's like my own personal Sudoku challenge to make whatever I want to say fit within 140 characters. Like, I will sit there for 5 minutes rephrasing, you know, 180 character message to fit under 140 characters with the initial, you know, feel of what I wanted to say, just because I have to. There's only 140 characters. I'm not breaking this into two tweets.
I love that. That's awesome.
You know, that's one of my joys of Twitter.
Well, that's one of the things that I think makes Twitter so wonderful, is that it forces creativity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. My, one of the ads that I did on Twitter for this show, for Richard's appearance, I don't know if it was the first or the second one, but that one is precisely 140 characters.
There's a nickname for people that do that. They talked about it on BOL back in 2009, and I can never remember what it's called. But if you're a person that consistently hits 140 characters exactly in all your tweets, there's a name for that.
That's funny.
Yeah,
it's like a tweet maximizer or something.
I can't remember, but yeah, it's pretty good. Like that's one of those things.
That's funny. So, I like that.
Yeah.
I apologize for the yawning. It's like 1:45 for me here.
Right. Yeah.
I'm good though. This is fun. And I'm fired up. It's been a shitty night.
All right. Well,
so I've got just a few more things that I want to bring up. Richard.
All right.
As you can tell, I'm growing out my facial hair and my hair on my head. And the primary reason that I'm doing it is because this is the first time in over two decades that I've been able to do it. So it's like,
you could. Right.
Right. So it's like I'm enjoying the freedom, the newfound freedom that I've got.
Right. But you're looking better groomed than like right after you retired, you looked kind of kept for a while.
Like homeless.
Yeah. Homeless. Well, that's the way I'm describing it.
I still have to go to work, so I do still have to groom. But I'm growing this out just because I can, I guess, but I don't really like it. So I'm thinking about doing something, and I'm just trying to get different people's opinions on what I should do with it. The one thing that I've actually kind of was thinking about doing is that, like, that undercut hairstyle.
Oh, my God. Are you kidding me? You follow me on Twitter. You know damn well how I feel.
What the hell's an undercut? What the fuck is
really?
An undercut?
You don't know what that is?
Look at me. Undercut. I barely have hair.
All right. Yeah. I think you need to get a hairstyle just like Amos. No. The undercut is, so you have a hairline in the front. So you kind of already lost it because you don't really have that. But just like me, I don't have that. But you have a hairline in the front. So you grow your hair really fucking long, and then you sweep it back. And then you shave your sides, and the hair on the top falls over a little bit where the sides are shaved. So it kind of covers up part of the shaved sides there. It's the stupidest fucking haircut I've ever seen in my mouth in my life. All he is doing right now is baiting me, because he knows that that's what I think. Now, The next stupidest haircut, actually, it might be more stupid, is if you have that haircut, but then you take that big swath of hair that you have, and you take that swath of hair and you wrap it all up and you create a fucking stupid ass man bun on the back of your head.
Oh, I hadn't even considered that.
That might be the total. That might be the stupidest fucking male haircut you can get today.
Oh, that's good. That's good. Okay, so
you should do that.
So a few of my favorite things are the paper towel dispensers in bathrooms. I also truly enjoy Silverlight.
Segway. What? Are you just like going through shit on my What Annoys Me account? Is that what's going on here? What are the buttons that I can push for app annoys me?
Yeah, that I've kind of been trolling you throughout the whole episode.
Yeah,
bringing up things that I know annoy you.
You'd be amazed how many things he brought up that you didn't react to. Yeah.
Yeah, you didn't seem to give a shit about Priuses. I thought you would.
Yeah, you know, I mean, but I'm okay with Priuses as long as you're not. What do they call that term? Like green hopping? What's the term where you drive so that you're optimizing your Prius?
I have no idea.
There's a term for that. That pisses me off.
Yeah, because people used to tell me I should do that in my Camry hybrid. And I was like, no.
Yeah.
So
and now, my car has an eco mode, and I'll drive it in the eco mode, and I get a lot of shit for doing that because I have a car that has a really nice engine, so it's kind of like a joke to turn it into eco mode. But
I'm pretty sure my Mustang. Yeah. I'm pretty sure my Mustang does not have an eco mode.
Yeah, it probably doesn't.
Well, my car actually has an eco mode, and it comes on automatically whenever you're going under 60 miles an hour. Of course, it's a Dodge Ram Power Wagon, you know, pushing over 400 horsepower. So anytime it wants to cut down to eco mode, I'm happy.
Yeah, because you're saving like a teaspoon of gas.
Well, yeah, but that teaspoon of gas gives me like 3 miles on a tank.
Right.
So,
oh my gosh.
Yeah, eco modes, and I don't know. I don't. It just seems silly to me.
All right, come on, bring it. What else? What else, Kent? Come on, bring it.
He's got a whole list of them here.
Oh yeah, I made a list of like 20 things from your What Annoys Me Twitter account. Oh my gosh. See, I tried to key in on the Shiner Holiday Cheer beer.
Oh my God!
You railed against that.
Have you tried that?
No, I tried a Shiner gift pack one time, and I thoroughly disliked everything in it. So I don't do Shiner.
That's a shame. So I really like Shinerbach. I think Shinerbach is a nice drinkable beer. It has flavor. I'm not an IPA guy, so
Okay. So that's like a resounding review right there. So what do you think about our beer? Well, it's drinkable.
No. But I mean, okay. If I go out to a bar, I'm not like, this is a really nice, I want to savor this. That's just like not how I drink beer. I drink beer, I'm going to like down a beer because it's, you know, it tastes good. But there are beers that you can't do that with. And that's just generally, that's normally not my thing. Like, I remember, last year at CES, I was there before you were. I don't know if you remember
South
this. South By. I sent you a picture of the beer menu at the hotel where I was staying.
Oh, yes. Yep.
I was like, dude, what should I try? You gave me a recommendation. And you're like, I think it was like a chocolate stout or something.
Yes,
and
yes, I tried it was.
Or no, peanut butter stout.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
And it was like drinking peanut butter. I mean, it was seriously, it was intense. It was really good, but it you know, that's not a drinkable beer. There's a different, right? Very different kind of.
Absolutely.
So I like Scheinerbach, and they have a really crazy beer that I've never tasted anything like before. That called, I think it's Redbird, Scheiner Redbird, and it is a ruby red grapefruit flavored beer.
That sounds awful.
I actually like it a lot.
Yeah. Grapefruit. Yeah. Like I've always associated grapefruit with old people.
I've always associated grapefruit with that.
Well, that's because of Fresca, and I like Fresca too.
I've always associated grapefruit with that look on your face when you give a, you know, get a teaspoon of lemon in your mouth, like.
No,
grapefruit can
old mouth. Right. But it's good, and I like that, and that's in that pack. But man, this Christmas stuff, because I thought, oh, nutmeg, that's kind of cool, I'll give that a try. A walnut, oh, that's a good idea. Oh yeah, peach, well, you know, maybe not so much. Oh my god, what were they thinking, seriously?
Oh, that sucks.
It's awesome.
I have a 12 pack of it in my garage refrigerator. You want it? I'll ship it to you.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Save the shipping cost. So I was gonna bring up banks closing early on Saturday.
Oh yeah, I switched my bank this weekend.
Yeah. Do they stay open late on Saturdays?
Yeah. No. So not kidding. Like my bank in DC, it was awesome. Is an old bank, used to be in DC for years and years and years. Some Pennsylvania company came in, bought the bank out, decided we're going to make it even more awesome. We're going to add extra hours. We're going to add extra services. They were open Saturdays. They were open Sundays. My bank was open on Sunday. I mean, how fucking cool is that?
That's crazy.
Right. And I was in town because they have one of those change machines. Like I have like baggies of change that I need to get turned, just like deposited in an account or something, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And you take it to the grocery store and they want 30% of that. Fuck that. I'm not giving them 30% of my money. So I'm like, well, my bank has that. So I'll go to my bank. And I go to my bank and it's 1 o'clock on Saturday and they're closed. I'm like, oh, fuck you. No, I'm not doing that. And that's where my deposit box is. Like I still have a deposit box where I have stuff. Like, what if I want to get my stuff on a Saturday? I can't get my stuff on a Saturday because they can't be bothered to be open. Right. So, actually, this past weekend, changed my bank. Fuck them. Bye. PNC, you suck.
Yeah. Oh, man. I'm so happy to be
rant. Come on. You can get another rant.
Right, one more. Okay. All right. Let me see. Let me find one that's probably what'll be a good one here. You had a chance to read through these, Amos. Do you have one that you think
this is in the hidden page? This is not in my version of this show notes.
No, no.
Of course
in
not.
In fact, I named these notes. These notes are B64 secret notes.
Right. Awesome.
Oh boy. Let's see. This one pissed me off. I don't have Showtime. But reading your tweet about this pissed me off. The online video authentication system that Showtime uses.
Oh my god.
I got pissed off for you.
So do you guys have Apple TV?
Yes.
So you know if you have TV services, the process that you have to go through to authenticate each and every fucking one of your TV services.
Right.
Yep. It's, which I ranted about on the first episode after I got my Apple TV.
It's insane. It's absolute bullshit. And I say this and it pains me to say this because I used to work as a contractor for one of the cable companies that was responsible for helping to define TV everywhere, to help make that a reasonable experience for customers, knowing that their customers wanted to get content off of the internet, but they were at the mercy of their license holders. And so they were required to do stupid shit like reauthenticate every 30 days or authenticate that you have a cable service, even though they were maybe giving the same content away for free over the air. Right. So right, you have to right. do all this stupid shit to be able to see this stuff and jump through hoops. And in the case of like PBS, I don't know if you've ever like tried to connect to PBS, but if you connect to PBS, I don't have a Facebook account. All right. But I have a Google account. So I connect with my Google account. So if you connect with Google, one of the default settings on Google for the longest time with PBS was we can see all of your friends. Fuck you. No, you're not going to see all of my friends so that I can watch TV. No, not doing that.
Yeah.
And so this process has just been ridiculous for years. Well, Showtime apparently has put a limit on how long your TV can be logged in to Showtime. And you know how fun it is to type in user IDs and passwords on a TV, right? Because you have the little remote control and your little up arrow and your left arrow and your down arrow.
Beep, 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 dunk.
Right.
Beep, 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 dunk.
Right. Yeah. And you get it wrong the first time every fucking time.
Yeah. Yep. He's like, motherfucker!
So, oh, that was awesome. So,
and don't forget the fact that you have to ask everybody to leave the room when you type in your password.
Yes! Right. Oh, my God.
Like, that's the other thing, because it shows you the letter that you're typing. What the hell are they thinking, right?
When I start doing that shit, when I have the remote in my hand and there's a password field on the screen, my boys just walk out of the room.
Yep.
they just know.
Yeah, that's how the kids are in my house, too.
Yep. Makes me insane. So just... You know, I had watched Showtime, I don't know, maybe like 3 weeks ago, because I watched the conclusion of Homeland. And then just like a week ago, I went in to watch something and I had to freaking re-authenticate. I'm like, are you kidding me? This is like, what the hell are you thinking? So I work during the day. I work for a digital agency where my responsibility is ensuring that our clients' experience, the clients that we serve, that their experience with us is the best that it can be. And when I see the shit that companies do in terms of how they treat their companies or their customers, I'm like, what the fuck are you thinking? It's just unbelievable.
You know, when you were describing your job, I couldn't help but think of Office Space and the guy that he was getting laid off. He's like, but I'm a people person. But I'm a people person. I'm good with people.
Yeah. All right. So my favorite one on here that that Kent acquired or tabulated, a dozen people in line at the post office. One person working.
Oh, my God. Christmas week. Christmas week.
Why wouldn't it be?
Christmas week. Our government at work. That's all I have to say.
So that parallels with one of my biggest pet peeves ever. And that is when, especially it's like at the bank or at Walmart, right? There's like four lanes open. And there are four separate lines for those four lanes.
Yeah.
As opposed to just making one fucking line and everybody takes their turn at whatever counter opens in turn of when they got in line. Everybody tries to game the system.
It took Best Buy 20 years to figure this out. But you know what? It works. One line.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. It's the simplest solution. It's the fairest solution. And it's the one that is going to be the most convenient for everybody involved. But they don't do it that way.
Yep.
And then at Christmas time, they finally decide, hey, we're only going to have one line, mostly because they can't have lines going shooting down every fucking aisle.
Right.
So then you got this one line, and the line is way long, and everybody's like, oh, my God, I can't believe the line's this long. And then everybody's cutting through, and the line is moving just quick as hell. But everybody's still frustrated.
That would have been awesome if they had someone at every station, but they had one person. One person in our nation's capital on Christmas week.
They're on leave. They want to take vacation. They saved up all year.
Their union allows them to do that. Oh, I just made so many enemies right there. Sorry.
So we have here on Osan Air Base in South Korea, we have the post office, and we had one person working and like nine people in line. Okay, fine. It's lunchtime. So I finally get to the front of the line. I'm like, hey, where's everybody else at? Thinking he's going to say they're at training or there's some other event going on today, or there's, you know, whatever, they're unloading stuff from the back. Hey, that's fine. If they're unloading a big shipment of stuff that just came in from the back, I understand why they're not at the front counter. No, he looked at me and goes, it's lunchtime.
Right, it's lunchtime.
For the entire fucking base, not just for your office. Clearly, that's serving the entire base.
Everybody has to eat lunch at the same time.
They're in the same building.
Why don't you understand that?
They are in the same building with the fucking food court.
No, it's like the legally to get food, obligated lunchtime.
Bullshit. Fuck off, they're military. Oh my God. I was so, like, that took me from hopeful and understanding to insta rage. Like, are you fucking kidding me? And then I had my cast on my hand, so I was like, okay, well, he was like, well, you need to fill this out and fill this out. I was like, right, so you're gonna do that. He was like, well, I can't hold up the entire line while I fill out these forms. I was like, well, you can hold up the entire line while everybody else is getting fucking food, so you can fill out these forms.
That's so the one thing that I have to give them is that as much as I was complaining about the fact that we were in line, and I was literally in line for an hour to mail 14 Christmas cards and a box. And so my time at the front of the line was all of like 3 minutes. And I have to tell you that when I finally got to the front of the line, she was like the most friendly person as can be. And you're in that position and you are still incredibly friendly and providing great customer service, then that is awesome. And I have to credit that. But seriously, the manager that decided that only one person needed to be there on Christmas week at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 3 days before the week ended. No, you should be fired. But you know what? We can't do that because you work for the government.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm all still right, in my probation
that's
period.
It. I don't have any more rants out in. I don't have any more. I'm done.
Yeah. But I was just gonna say, as a federal employee, I'm still in my my probation period where I can be let go for no reason.
Picking your nose wrong.
They don't even need a reason. Yeah, like my boss can be like, yeah, we don't need you anymore. And then I just don't go to work anymore.
But and podcast full time.
Once I hit the 1 year mark, yeah, there's no firing me.
No. So like I basically have to commit a federal job after working for the government in the military.
At the same place he used to work.
Yeah. Well, the same base, yeah. Yeah, I didn't really want to get federal employment, but there was no. I live in Alamogordo. There was no beating that pay.
Hey, if it's the right job for you, then you can't beat it, right? I'm not. I don't want to put you on the spot because.
No. I couldn't argue it. I principally, like, who I want to B, I guess, is not a federal employee, but
fiscally,
I could not argue. There's nothing in this town unless you are a doctor or a lawyer,
right?
Or you own some company.
He's reached the peak of his fiscal advantage in this world.
Yeah, but yeah, other than like the three things that I mentioned, there is no better paying job in this area than being a GS employee on base.
Hmm. Have you tried like an online porn service or something? I mean, I hear they're like,
I'll look into that. I'll look into that.
Oh, wow.
I could be one of those call-in guys, but I'll be like the, I don't know, like the trans chick or whatever.
No. Just run it. You don't have to like make an appearance or anything.
Oh, I got you. Oh, okay. I thought you were saying like, you know, work for commission or something.
Be management.
Oh, shit. I wouldn't even know how to go about that.
Talent scout, baby.
Oh my God. Yeah, okay, I'll look into that.
All right. I'm sorry, did I push the boundaries of the show too far? Yeah, right.
No. Wait. There are boundaries?
They're out there somewhere.
Yeah.
But we're still looking for them.
Yeah, whenever Sergeant Muffin says, you guys can't be on DCTV anymore, that's when we've reached the boundary.
Yeah.
Right.
And I don't think that'll be because of content.
Speaking of boundaries, so we've been talking for a really long time, and I'm actually really glad that Tay didn't call, because I know that if she called, it didn't matter who it was going to be, she was going to cut in. Right? You have a new rule that if Tay ever calls, that you're just interrupting anyone you're talking to, and she gets the floor.
Pretty much, yeah.
We can have POTUS online, and Tay's getting through.
Well, after his State of the Union address, I'm pretty sure if Richard called, we'd interrupt the POTUS.
Well, I mean, I'm thinking, you know, if he had a chance of being on the WTF podcast, why couldn't he be on Ritual Misery, right?
I'm thinking at this point, he would be lucky to be on our podcast.
Wow. Was the State of the Union that bad? I didn't actually listen to it.
I have no idea. I didn't listen to it either.
I didn't listen to it. I heard mostly positive things about it.
I still think he'd be lucky to be on our podcast.
I heard that the future looks really strong, but I also heard that every president says that in every State of the Union address.
Right, especially their last one, when they're not going to be responsible for what happens later.
Yep.
So.
Yep.
All right, well, Richard, it's about time for us to let you go, because I'm sure that bottle of wine is, saying hello pretty well.
Yeah, I made a dent.
All right, people can find you at Richard Gunther on Twitter.
They can. That actually manages to aggregate all of my voices, including what annoys me, which is apparently Kent's favorite of my voices. And it is probably.
I think it might be the one you post to the most.
So it is one that I post to the most. And what's funny is that I have like old school followers. Like I have people that followed me from way. Ooh, wow, that was nice. Way back when I started on Twitter, like Molly Wood and others that I knew, like when Twitter was just starting. And that's the account that those people follow. So, you know, I have to keep true to that. I have to keep my angry, disappointed in life self on that. Yeah. And that and all my other voices are all aggregated. You don't have to follow that. You can follow Richard Gunther on Twitter. And it's all in that place. And if you happen to be into tech stuff, I host a podcast about home automation. It's called Home On. Search for Home On TuneIn or on.
Now, can you break that down into two words?
Yeah. So, Home On. It's like you're telling your home to turn on.
Wow.
And if you type those
it's like
two words,
instead of saying Siri or Alexa, you say home,
on.
And on is the command. Right. Yes,
exactly. Just like that. And if you type those two words into iTunes or into TuneIn, you're going to find my show.
What two words was that?
Oh, home on.
Okay. I think we have it now.
All right, good.
Where else can people find you?
It's a good show, by the way.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'm actually more interested in home automation as I listen to it than I was ever
before. No, you're
before.
So not. You like it, totally admit that you're not into home automation, and that's okay. Right. You don't have to be into home automation, but, you know, because you're my friend, I expect you to listen anyway.
I do. I do, actually. So here's the thing. I've listened to a couple episodes, you know, when you had people on it that I knew or whatever. And it's a good show and talks about some things, but I'm not all that into home automation. And then what happens is I'm sitting there and I'm like, hey, there's a new home on. Okay. And I'll sit there and listen to it. Like it hasn't gotten into my, my holy shit, there's one on. I got to listen to it now. But it's like one tier below that.
Yeah. And
which makes it one tier above this show.
You're not listening to it to listen to me, right? I mean, and I'm not saying you, but people aren't listening to it to listen to me. I have some really great guests, mm-hmm. and I'm really thrilled to be connected with the people that I am. I've had editors from CNET. I've had Tom Merritt. I've had CEOs of different home automation companies on. I have an analyst, Mike Wolf, who's a pretty regular guest on the show. So I'm really very fortunate to, through various connections over the last dozen years or so, be pretty connected. And those are the people that you tune in for. And I think that if you're interested in that space, it's going to be interesting to you.
Yeah, it's definitely a growing market. Sure. That's got plenty of space to for things to talk about and areas to look into. So,
yeah, for sure.
All right, and Entertainment 2.0.
Yeah, Entertainment 2.0. I say that kind of as a footnote. A lot of people are not so much into the home theater PC space anymore, but we talk a lot about if you're into kind of, you know, managing your own home theater, managing your own content, or if you're into what's going on in the Microsoft world for home entertainment, like I still use Media Center. Remember Media Center? I don't know. Most people don't even know that Media Center, a DVR, a really awesome DVR, came for free with their Windows because Microsoft did a shitty job of promoting it. But it's there. It's awesome. And if you didn't give in to the upgrade to Windows 10 for free propaganda, then you still have a really good version of this pretty cool DVR and other entertainment software that you can use whenever you want to.
So I just recently set up a Plex server in my little apartment here.
Oh yeah, that's pretty awesome too. Yeah.
And I've discovered that my old Windows computer is not strong enough to power it.
Oh yeah, yeah. I have a Drobo that has Plex built into it. And about half of the content that is on my Plex server, I get a message when I click it that says, this server does not have sufficient capability to encode this content.
Yeah, I wish I got a message. I just get skips.
So. Yeah, it shouldn't even bother at that point, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Was that at 10x urging, Amos?
For the Plex server?
I know TinVec. Yeah, TinVec talks about that.
I don't. He might have been the one who planted the seed, but it was just something that that I was like, you know what? I want to watch this stuff over there, you know. And then Plex came out with their PlayStation 4 client went free, so I was like, okay, well, it's time to try it.
Oh shit!
So Coda decided that he needed to say goodbye tonight, so he wanted to be on the show. Look over there. There you go.
Oh, hey, puppy.
Yeah, small puppy.
Awesome.
Yeah, small puppy. All right,
so can't we have another guest on next week? Who's that?
Francis Madeira. He is the owner and operator of Hip Hops, which is a successful Kickstarter that resulted in a card game all about beer that is a shitload of fun, has absolutely beautiful artwork, represents craft brews from around the world. Check out these amazingly beautiful cards. Like, look at that shit. That is awesome. They were voted on by the Kickstarter participants. So good. The game is so fun. Absolutely love it.
And a sponsor of this show, as it were.
Oh, yeah. As luck would have it. Yeah. So Hip Hops does, in fact, sponsor this show. Our first and only sponsor.
You shut your fat mouth.
I think he has probably been on the show as many times as I have been.
He's been on
three times.
I think he's only twice. Been on once.
Once?
No, he's only. Twice.
I thought he was on, twice before, and this will be his third.
I'm not sure. Either way, he'll be on next week. So if you have questions about
the game,
I don't
know. But in any event, he's a great guest. He's a lot of fun to listen to. Get his audio right.
Yeah.
Have I mentioned that I'm an audio snob? Have I mentioned that?
Right. Well, we have a guest guide now.
Yeah.
If you haven't seen it, and Woo-hoo! It covers a lot of these topics. And all when right. I sent it to him, like probably a month ago, I sent him the guest guide, and he was like, "Oh, that, you know, hey, this has been extremely helpful." So,
yeah,
should be good.
Actually, the last time he was on, I think he was on twice, because if I remember correctly, first time he was on, he had some audio problems. I know I wrote you guys about it because,
mm-hmm.
you know, we're friends, right? We can share. I can bullshit yes. with you guys about that.
Yes.
And
well, a lot of people might not know that Richard was basically our mentor, and still in a lot of ways is our mentor for this podcast.
As yes, Ken's audio guys, goes to shit.
I don't even want to hear about that, right? You're like talking about how Brian's going to be providing you with some fundraising ideas now. So I'm like so far in the tailwind now, it's not even funny. But
oh, no.
nonetheless.
No. So off. We never forget our origins.
All right, good.
Because we're so huge.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah. We're still in beta. We right.
Still yeah, we're still in beta. Come on.
I'm expecting my mug next week.
I ordered a t-shirt. I'm a little disappointed that it didn't come today. So I was really wanting to wear it today and
see.
I guess next week.
Perfect.
See, and I'm really shitty. I'm going to wait until Kent gets his shirt so he can review it on the show, so then I can know whether or not to order mine.
Perfect. Oh, that's great.
All right, Kent, where can people find you at, man?
Of course, they can find me on Twitter, @RM_DelNoche. I've been a lot more active over the last few weeks than I have been previously. If you're a beer guy like me and you want to see what I think about certain beers to include Shiner varieties, you can go to ratebeer.com and look up username Del Noche.
All right.
What about you, Amos?
At Ethan Kane on Twitter, of course.
Oh, that makes so much sense.
It does. It really does.
The man of many names.
Yeah, you know. Again, I was late in the train on branding. So, hell, the Ritual Misery podcast got its name from from high school. Tells you how good we're doing. I've also got a new podcast out called Undaunted, and I'm having some great interviews. Well, I don't say interviews, conversations. With different podcasters from all walks of life on there talking about how they got into podcasting and some of the different things that they've noticed through their podcasting, ways that they've grown, and ways that their show has changed their life and the way that their life has changed the show. So got several more of those coming out, and I'm hoping to line up some more interviews here shortly. And of course, you can follow the show @RitualMisery. Submit ideas or subreddit ritualmisery.reddit.com. My lung butter bronchitis is about to attack me again. This is bullshit. I was never really sick until I started this podcast. Now I'm like sick all the time. It just pisses me off.
Because you're always talking, right? It's like you always have to be on the spot, and that puts pressure on you. So stress makes you sick.
Damn it! I need to start drinking more orange juice. So, because apparently that works. I read on Twitter that works.
I heard that.
All right. So you can submit your ideas on our subreddit, ritualmisery.reddit.com. You can email us podcast@ritualmisery.com. If you want to call and leave us a voicemail, you'll probably hear your own voice on this very show. You can call us at 567-69-TRMPC. That's 567-698-7672.
Special thanks to Kevin McLeod for allowing us to use his music on incomptech.com. For Kent, for Richard, and for me, this has been your Ritual Misery Podcast.
See ya.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.